These are inanimate objects, and inanimate objects are incapable of doing any harm in and of themselves. And people shouldn't be arrested simply because they're carrying some sort of inanimate object and not doing anything wrong with it.
Welcome to the Knife Junkie Podcast, your weekly dose of knife news and information about knives and knife collecting. Here's your hosts, Jim Person and Bob the Knife Junkie DeMarco.
Well, hello, Knife Junkies. Welcome to the Knife Junkie Podcast. I'm Jim Person.
And I'm Bob DeMarco from thenifejunkie.com. Welcome to the show.
Another good one for you. We've had had this guest on before. It's a repeat, but some good information. Doug Ritter with us from Knife Rights. Going to be talking specifically about some legislative action that happened in four states plus New York City. So good interview and timely with some of the recent action that's happened in those jurisdictions, Bob.
That's right. We talk about Texas, Ohio, Montana, Virginia, which hits close to home for us, and New York City and all that's happening there. Mm-hmm. And we also dip into, we talk a little bit about the Ultimate Steal there, the Knife Rights donation drive. And it is well worth your time and money to become a member of Knife Rights. And when you listen to Doug Ritter talking about all that they've been doing across the nation, you'll see what I mean.
Yeah, ultimatesteel.org is where you can find out more information about that. And I think you'll be just blown away by the dollar amount of stuff that is in that giveaway, that fundraising event, if you will.
Yeah, I mean, just from donating, you could win one of 30 special Ritter Griptilians with the with Damascus blades, or you could win any one of a number of custom knives, and they have that just tons of sharpening systems, all sorts of different things, like $160,000 worth of prizes. So it's worth your while to get involved with Knife Rights.
A lot of good stuff. So again, that's ultimatesteel.org. You can learn more about that. And I want to remind you that our podcast today is brought to you by Audible. If you love audio like I do, and I know Bob does, you can get a free audiobook download and a 30-day free trial by simply going to audibletrial.com/knifejunkie. There's over 180,000 titles to choose from for your iPhone, your Android Kindle, or even your MP3 player. Again, all you have to do is go online to audibletrial.com/knifejunkie and get a free audiobook download right now and a 30-day free trial. So, Bob, I can't wait to hear more about the giveaway, the ultimatesteel.org, as well as kniferights.org, as well as the legislative action that's happening in this jurisdiction. So what do you say we jump right into that interview?
Yeah, let's find out.
Do you use terms like handle-to-blade ratio, walk-and-talk, hair-poppin' sharp, or tank-like? Then you are a dork and a knife junkie.
Doug, I wanted to welcome you back onto the Knife Junkie Podcast. Thank you so much for coming back on. It's a pleasure to have you.
My pleasure.
Before we talk about some of the action happening in some states recently with knife rights and their knife legislation, I wanted to ask you a little bit about what's happening with the Hoegh-made RSK Mark I. And the reason I ask is a selfish one. After we spoke last time, I went on the web to find one and buy one and realized that it's an exclusive and that I'd have to wait. Which was a bummer because I wanted it right then and there.
I can assure you that that we're as frustrated as you are, but Hoegh has shipped the first shipment of new knives again back into production today, literally.
Oh, nice.
So they will start flowing out every Monday, Tuesday, or Wednesday over the next continuing weeks. We hope to get the backlog filled here shortly and then be able to go forward from there.
Well, so I'm kind of giving the world a real inside scoop here because I know there are going to be a lot of people who are kind of clamoring to get that knife.
We have that problem, which is compared to other problems, we could have a lot worse problems.
Yeah. But, yeah.
It is frustrating. Hoegh is producing them as fast as they can, given all the circumstances they have to deal with, including some major government contracts that they've gotten. You know, we're hoping that over the next few months, they will be delivering on a regular basis, which will put us in a position to do some fun stuff. As you may have noticed, the $1,000 donation bonus knife in this year's Ultimate Steel is actually one of my knives with a carbon fiber handles and Damascus steel blade.
Well, tell listeners about the Ultimate Steel. That sounds beautiful. And tell everyone what the Ultimate Steel is and how they can win this gorgeous RSK MK1.
Well, they can't actually win that one because that was for the first 20 donors who donated $1,000. But we have $160,000 in growing worth of prizes in the Ultimate Steel, from $10,000 knives to $4,000, $5,000 firearms packages with optics and suppressors, sterling silver jewelry, sharpeners. There are a lot, hundreds of prizes worth thousands and thousands of dollars. Right now, over 160,000. It's growing.
That's
literally
amazing.
Every day. Every single one of those prizes is 100% donated. So all the money that you donate to Knife Rights goes to help us get things done. The early bird drawing, which is production knives and sharpeners and pens and stuff like that, that drawing closes May 30th. So anyone listening ought to try and get their donations in before then, because that enters you in two separate drawings. And even if you win in the early bird, your entry is put back in for the main drawing. So you really get double the chances to win something.
So let me ask you, Doug, did you get one of these Damascus bladed carbon fiber handled MK1s yourself?
Or? No. This is a fundraiser.
Yes. Okay. All right.
But it's indicative of the sort of things that could be done going forward.
Right.
So, you know, we'll see how the reaction is. The 20 knives that were set for $1,000 donors, those went in like 15 hours. So they didn't last long.
So raising funds for Knife Rights. Knife Rights, an organization that you started that is going state by state throughout the union, trying to repeal or change antiquated knife laws, laws that were born of different eras when the country was concerned with, well, different concerns. And these laws have largely gone forgotten. And you might be a criminal walking around having no idea. So you and your organization, Knife Rights, has been changing that over the past, what, 10 years, right? 10, 12 years?
Well, we really got started at the state level in 2010, so 9 years. 30 bills passed in 21 states in 9 years. Not a bad record.
Not a bad record at all. So I was on the website today preparing to talk to you, and I want to talk about five or so of these. And a couple of them strike home because two of them are, one is in the state I grew up in, and the other is the state in which I currently live. But first, I want to talk about Ohio. What's going on with the Ohio knife law reform?
The Ohio bill was introduced just a few days ago, May 1st. It will remove the ban on the production, manufacture, and sale of automatic knives, switchblade knives, which are currently allowed to be possessed, but you can't manufacture or sell them, which is absurd. It would also remove all the banned knives from Ohio law. Ohio's knife laws are pretty vague. This simply strikes all of those, as well as a few other odds and ends like knuckles and slingshots and billies and that sort of thing.
And there's this thing here, cestus, which I had to look up. It's the leather wraps that a gladiator wears around his hand when he's boxing. And apparently you can't have those in Ohio either.
No, but if we succeed in this, you will be able to. So
walk up and down Main Street with those things on, you know?
Yeah. I mean, it is our goal when we go into a state to simply strike their bans entirely. And certainly that's where we're going with this one. Senator Eaker has been great to work with. It's been great getting the language right. And by getting rid of the knives out of the state's ban and by putting in an exception to their catch-all deadly weapons other than a handgun that basically says, for the purposes of this section, deadly weapon or weapon does not include any knife, razor, or cutting instrument if the instrument was not used as a weapon. Which is the way it ought to be.
Because it's like walking around with a hammer, essentially.
Yeah, it's a tool. And it's only a weapon if it's used as a weapon. And then you deal with whether it's a question of self-defense or it's an offensive use of the weapon, which would be illegal. And you go from there. I mean, these are inanimate objects. Inanimate objects are incapable of doing any harm in and of themselves. And people shouldn't be arrested simply because they're carrying some sort of inanimate object and not doing anything wrong with it.
Which leads me to Virginia, the state in which I currently reside. And last time we spoke, this had just happened, but we decided to table the conversation to a later date. Break down a little bit what happened here in the state of Virginia with switchblades.
Right now, possession of switchblades is entirely banned. This effort was an effort to assist the manufacturers and distributors that are in Virginia, including Blue Ridge Knives, which is the largest knife distributor in the world, and allow them to participate in the huge market for these knives throughout the United States. I mean, at this point, you know, 45 states allow switchblades to one degree or another. That's a huge market that they're locked out of. So the effort was successful in that it passed both the Assembly and the Senate with bipartisan support. We had indications that the governor was going to allow it to become law. And then he issued a pretty striking veto of the bill, which, you know, is unfortunate. It took us a bit by surprise. It wasn't what we were expecting. And, you know, it's frustrating when you work so hard to get something done to suddenly have a governor veto something that, you know, doesn't make any sense. This was all about commerce. This was, it had nothing at all to do with carry, which might have been a bridge too far for Virginia. And the governor basically said, you know, since we don't allow our citizens to carry these, we're not going to help anyone in any other state carry them, which is just, that's just about as absurd a reaction as you can imagine.
Or even help anyone in this state produce them and sell them out of state. Like, we don't even want the money from it. It's so dangerous. And I think what must be remembered is that Governor Northam was in hot water at the time. They had people looking at him up and down because of all of his, you know, yearbook pictures and all of that. You remember what was happening with him then. And so this struck me as a 100% political move without any rationality or thought that went into it. And if you read his response, it was quite terse. It was a 5-line paragraph, if I remember correctly.
And that's pretty typical of governor's veto messages.
Yeah, once I guess in a while, I waste a lot of time on it.
Yeah, I mean, this bill would have benefited one of the most economically depressed areas of the state, where adding one job would be huge. And this had the possibilities of adding dozens of jobs. So there's no rational sense to these things, and that's not unusual when we do get a veto. We've had vetoes before, and we have come back and succeeded in getting bills passed. And we don't give up easily, and we'll be back to, you know, try to get this done next year.
Administrations change and such. But, you know, people have to remember, it's not just the jobs created by the one small knife making factory. It's the, you know, delivery driver jobs. It's the cafe down the street that's selling more coffee. You know, these all have ripple effects, these kind of decisions. And that really bummed me out. I have to say, I didn't grow up in Virginia. When I moved here, I kind of felt like, oh, I'm moving to like a southern state. Things are going to be a little more to my liking in those kind of terms. And I was wrong about that.
There was a time, but Virginia has turned very purple. Mm-hmm. You know, they have elections coming up this year, which could turn the state blue depending upon how things go. So it's, you know, for these kind of issues, it's not a good place to be. I mean, hopefully things will change. We're going to certainly continue working. Had a conversation just earlier this week on some possible strategies that we might use next year going in. I mean, the bad thing is you got a veto. The good thing is when you get a veto, you have a much clearer picture of what you need to do to address those issues. And you know, part of the secret to our success is we don't give up. I mean, there have been many states where it's taken years and years to get things done. I mean, the bill that we just filed in Ohio, I mean, we've been working with the senator there for maybe 4 years to get this done. And, you know, all the stars have to align politically, and they have, and now the bill is filed, and now hopefully we'll get that done. I mean, Texas is a state where this is our fourth session over 8 years that we've had a bill to continue to peel back the layers of their knife bans.
Location-restricted knife, what is that?
So back in 2017, when our bill got rid of all the illegal knives, took that out of statute in Texas. Tragically, a week before the bill was to be voted on originally, a young man was murdered, stabbed to death at the university campus, literally blocks from the Capitol. And as a result of that, we got most of what we wanted, but they took the old 5.5-inch knife rule that you couldn't carry, and it became location-restricted knives that were restricted from carry in bars and amusement parks and houses of worship and places of execution and schools and places like that. So what we're attempting this year is to continue to roll back their bans by removing the location-restricted knife locations from bars and amusement parks and places of worship, all places where someone should ought to be able to easily, readily carry a knife that's 5.5 inches or more.
So those locations don't necessarily ban you from carrying a knife. They ban you from carrying a knife with a blade over 5.5 inches. Is
that correct?
Okay.
Our definition of reasonable is no restrictions. So, you know, we're working on it. It's the bill has passed the Senate. It's out of the House committee. So it's ripe to be passed. We don't foresee a problem going forward, but it's politics. You never know. Every bill we've run in Texas has ended up being passed at the 11th hour. But we are working there. Todd Rathner, my director of legislative affairs, has been to Texas 5 times so far this year. He's spent the better part of, you know, 4 weeks total there altogether in the 5 trips. It takes a lot of effort to get Texas legislation passed. I fully expect him to be back in Texas next week working on this, and then on to Ohio. You know, there's a reason that Todd and I travel 100,000 miles a year, because that's right. How you get things done.
Yeah, in person, face-to-face, I would imagine, especially yep. With something like this, you know, which might need a little face-to-face convincing if someone is aligning it unfairly with NRA issues or other.
You get action when you're the squeaky wheel, and being the squeaky wheel in person and being the squeaky wheel over telephone or via text or email is a whole lot different.
Right, exactly. Yeah, exactly. And showing up year after year is also an important.
Yeah, at this point, everyone in the Texas legislature knows who Todd is.
You know, I think Texas has this traditional sort of image as being a kind of a live and let live kind of place, you know, especially when it comes to weapons. And so I was surprised to see any sort of, you know, restrictive legislation here. But then I saw that it contains 2 of the 10 worst anti-knife cities in America. And that was a little surprising.
At one point it did, until we got preemption passed. So Texas isn't nearly as Texas as everyone thinks it is. But as I told the governor when we did a signing ceremony in 2017 for the bill that finally allowed Texans to carry a Bowie knife, I said, you know, sir, we're honored to be able to make Texas more like everyone thinks Texas is. And that got a good laugh out of the governor.
Yeah.
but really, that's what we're doing. I mean, people have a vision of Texas that doesn't really align with the reality. And we're busy making Texas like everyone thinks Texas is by getting rid of their restrictions.
So I saw that you had some really good news in Montana.
Montana, we passed our bill that got rid of their ban, or their extremely limited ban on switchblades, and we passed knife law preemption so that state law prevails over any local restrictions. They're now null and void. That that's a big win for us. It was a bipartisan effort. We had a Democratic governor sign the bill. He seemed thrilled with receiving the specially engraved Protec autos.
Yeah, what a sweet gift.
Our good friends at Protec, Dave Wattenberg, literally we found out we were going to have a signing ceremony 2 days before, and he literally turned those out overnight for us. Great friend, great supporter, stupendous effort on his part to get them out and then overnighted to us. One of our board members, Ethan Becker, lives part-time in Montana and was able to literally drive there for the signing ceremony. So it really went off well. We love doing that with governors that help us get rid of knife restrictions by signing the bills that their legislatures pass.
And what a what a beautiful way to mark that than with a Protec. And Les George, I'm extremely fond of his designs. It's a beautiful little knife. It's for those who haven't seen it yet, it's a mini version of the Rockeye auto folder. And what a great way to show the person who just allowed this to happen why, and that it's a great little tool.
It was his first auto, and I understand that he's been flicking it around the Capitol since he got
constantly
it.
Driving everyone crazy within earshot. This reminds me a little bit of something you mentioned last time we spoke. You wanted to underline the fact that a lot of knife legislation, I suggested it was born out of hysteria from movies like Rebel Without a Cause, and you took it back even further. You said it was more of a Jim Crow kind of a restrictive law, racially charged. Could you explain that for me?
Sure. So there have been two waves of knife restrictions that have passed through the United States. Prior to the Civil War, knife restrictions were virtually unheard of any sort. After the Civil War, as you note, there were a number of Jim Crow laws passed. Among the laws that were passed were restrictions on large knives. Some of these were length limits. A lot of them named Bowie knives and Arkansas toothpicks and other types of large knives that were viewed as weapons, as restricted items. And this was a way of keeping what were perceived as weapons out of the hands of the newly freed blacks. Sad commentary, certainly something that we want to roll back. The second wave of knife restrictions, which was on automatic knives, switchblades as they were commonly called then, came in the 1950s as a result of, as you note, hysteria over the inaccurate portrayal of gangs and such in big cities that also had its racial overtones. Since, for example, West Side Story, you had the Puerto Ricans. It's unfortunate. By the same token, when we work to get these laws repealed, we get support from both sides, in part because, unfortunately, still today, a disproportionate number of people of color are those who are arrested for carrying knives. In New York City, where our cases is on appeal to the Supreme Court, 80% of the individuals arrested are persons of color, even in white majority neighborhoods. That's just not a good thing. And it's one of the reasons that we get support from both sides of the aisle. It's a criminal justice reform issue on the one side, and it's all about freedom on the other. And it's one of those rare issues where we can meet in the middle, and we both have a reason for wanting to support this. And we're able to move almost all our bills with bipartisan support, sometimes incredible bipartisan support. I mean, our bill, it's not unusual, move unanimously.
What is the situation in New York City?
So our petition for writ of certiorari is at the Supreme Court. The DA and New York City declined to provide a response. Without a response, the court typically doesn't take a case. The court required a response. They directed the city and DA to respond. That is due on May 13th. Once that is in, we will have a chance to respond. We have till the 28th, which, because of Memorial Day, basically we have till the Friday before that to respond to their response. And then we ought to be on one or the other or both of the June calendar conference calendars when they'll make a decision whether they're going to take the case. So we've got three very strong amicus briefs that have been filed. We believe it's a strong case. It'll be interesting to see what the city and the DA come up with in their response to try to tell the court that this isn't a case worth taking. We have a circuit split, which is important. We have a strong constitutional question to be settled.
What exactly is that question?
Oh, so it's a little complicated.
Okay, maybe you don't have to exactly.
I'll see if I can distill it down to really the basics of the issue.
Okay.
So while the genesis of the case was about the issue of New York City arresting and prosecuting individuals simply because they were carrying common pocket knives that supposedly officers were able to wrist flick open. While that was the key of the case, the court is less interested in that. What they're really interested in is what constitutional issues have arisen from the way the case was decided. When the Second Circuit decided the case, they actually gifted us, if you will, with a strong constitutional case where there's a big difference between the decision they made relating to vagueness issues, which have constitutional underpinnings between them and other circuits. And one of the jobs that the Supreme Court has is settling differences in how constitutional issues are dealt with by different circuits. So ideally, the Supreme Court wants all the circuits to deal with similar issues in the same manner. What the Second Circuit did was really take one type of vagueness issue and say, nope, we're going to treat it as this type of vagueness issue. And because we're treating it as that kind of vagueness issue, you lose. That's an extraordinarily simplified version of a very complicated legal issue. But the bottom line is that it put them in conflict with other circuits. And that allows us to have a strong case.
It's like a little wiggle room.
Yeah, the Supreme Court, you have to understand, the Supreme Court gets over 1,000 cases a year. They take maybe 100. And the Supreme Court is less about justice and more about, as I say, making sure that decisions are consistent among the different districts in the
U.S. So that's how they're going to choose their cases for the season.
Right, which was why the fact that the Second Circuit decided this in a way that set up this conflict between the circuits actually helps us, because now we have a real, honest to God, constitutional issue that is caused in part by some previous decisions that the Supreme Court had made not particularly clearly. So it's the sort of thing which, depending upon the mood the justices are in and how important they think this is, does fall into the more commonly than not, these are the type of cases that are decided by the Supreme Court. And we should know by the end of June whether they're going to take the case. I mean, meanwhile, we also have this issue going through the legislature in New York again. The bill to fix the gravity knife issue in New York City passed the New York Assembly unanimously and is now on to the Senate.
So the main issue there was how many times it took any given police officer to flick it open, flick the knife open with gravity.
Nope.
Wrong issue.
Well, same issue, little different front. That was a lower court decision finding the law unconstitutional, but very narrowly, and really has no bearing on or effect. So the result of that can sort of be set aside. It made a lot of headlines. It probably ended up with people being arrested because they suddenly thought that they were good. But it really had no effect on 99% of the people who were going to get arrested. It just meant that law enforcement officers were going to try harder to open these knives the first time. But the bill would remove gravity knives from all the statutes in New York State where they're illegal. So it would solve the problem with common folding knives being considered gravity knives by saying gravity knives are fine. They're not illegal. And that bill has passed the assembly and is now over in the Senate. You know, this is not unlike bills that have been vetoed by Governor Cuomo twice before. By the same token, you know, it's not entirely unforeseen that he would, if we get granted cert, in other words, the court says they want to hear the case, it's entirely possible that he may decide, okay, I don't really want a Supreme Court decision on this much broader issue that affects a lot of stuff, and I would rather just sign your stupid bill. And so I don't really care how we win. I mean, if we win because our success in getting the bill to be heard by the Supreme Court forces or pushes the governor to sign our bill as an alternative to potentially losing that case, I'm good with that. I'll take the win any way we can, especially after, you know, basically it'll be 8 years this summer.
Yeah, slogging away. You take it how you can get it.
Yeah. I mean, a win is a win is a win.
Especially when you look at what the results are, you know, and the freedoms gained back. So I want to ask you a couple of questions before we wrap. One is kind of a general question. It's an opinion question. What are the best places and the worst places in the United States to be a knife enthusiast?
Well, certainly the best places are states where we've gotten rid of their knife laws entirely, starting with Arizona, which was the first state we passed preemption. We've got Alaska, we've got Oklahoma, we've got Kansas. There's a series of states. Worst places, certainly New York, New Jersey, Virginia is not very friendly to certain types of knives. Pennsylvania.
Really? Pennsylvania? That's shocking to me because there are so many people making knives in Pennsylvania.
Yeah, there are, some of which are being made in violation of the state laws, but that's a whole nother issue. The point being that what we do is peel back layers of the onion, okay? And the more we get done in one place, the easier it's going to be eventually to get things done in states where they're going to be the last man standing. I mean, nobody ever thought that Illinois would ever allow concealed carry of firearms. Mm-hmm. And eventually, when every other state allowed it, they finally got that. And just a couple of years after that, we got rid of their ban on switchblades for the most part. So, you know, you just, the secret is to keep plugging away. I would like, before we close, encourage folks to go to kniferights.org or to our ultimatesteel.org page, donate, get a chance to win some incredible custom knives, firearms packages, African safari. I mean, these are incredible prizes that people can win.
So they can just access this through the kniferights.org
If they go website to kniferights.org, it's on the right. Just click on it.
Okay.
On the right side of the page, or it's down the page a ways if you're on your mobile phone, or just go to ultimatesteel.org, which takes you direct to the Ultimate Steel website.
All right, Doug, one last question, and I feel like I should ask this of you every time I talk to you, so so it's underlined in my mind and highlighted in everyone else's mind. What should you do if you're stopped by a police officer for whatever reason and you're carrying knives?
So the first thing you should do is not say anything. That is the key to everything that follows. That will make your lawyer's job so much easier. If you become a Knife Rights member, you get a membership card. On the back of the membership card are Evan Knappen's SAC mnemonic. S, remain silent. I assert my right to remain silent. A, ask for an attorney. I want my or I want an attorney. C, do not consent to any search. Do not make or sign any statement without your attorney's approval. You have to be respectful, polite, and cooperative. You certainly don't want to physically resist under any circumstances, but you have to remain silent. You will have to reassert your request for an attorney over and over again. Just don't relent. Just remain silent. There's a great video out there on YouTube that I strongly recommend. everyone view. It's called Don't Talk to the Police by Regent Law School Professor James Duane. It is a encapsulation of all the things that can go wrong to a totally innocent person by talking to the police. Just keep your mouth shut, remain silent, assert your right to remain silent, and your attorney's going to have a lot better chance of getting you out. And it is very, very hard, especially for innocent people, to keep quiet.
Yeah, because they'll be convinced of my innocence if I only tell them what I was doing.
The key is, number one, remain silent. Ask for your attorney and do not consent to a search. If you can do those three things, your attorney will thank you, your family will thank you, and the cops will respect you. They may not be happy that you actually know what the rules are, but they will respect you.
Well, there you have it, people. Go to kniferights.org and go over to the right side of the page, click on the Ultimate Steal and donate. You could win part of $160,000 worth of amazing knives, custom knives, guns, and other things. Follow Knife Rights on Facebook, Twitter. They're on Instagram. And keep up with what Doug is doing and help support Knife Rights, because they are out there fighting for each one of us. Doug, I want to thank you for coming back on the Knife Junkie podcast. It's been a pleasure talking with you. And thank you so much for everything you're doing for us.
I appreciate it. And thank you for having me on and for supporting our efforts.
Have a question, or maybe you just have a comment? Give us a call at 724-466-4487. We'll answer your question on an upcoming episode of the Knife Junkie podcast. That number again, 724-466-4487.
Welcome back to the Knife Junkie podcast. Bob, another great interview, a repeat guest with us, Doug Ritter, but definitely a guest worth having back on a second time, and just fascinating to hear some of the behind-the-scenes kind of stuff that they're working on in some of these big states, as well as the ongoing stuff going on in New York City.
Yeah. If you want to talk to someone who really has their finger on the pulse of what's happening in the knife world in terms of the legality, I mean, it's easy to get dizzy with all these amazing knives around, but it's also good to just ground yourself and anchor yourself and remember, you know, the waters you're swimming in. And you could get in big trouble for carrying around some amazing knife that you're just carrying around because it's an amazing knife.
Right. Couple of things I listened to and heard in that interview. I think he said 45 states allow switchblades.
Yep.
And then the YouTube video that he was promoting, I think Don't Talk to the Police by James Duane, I believe, a good video I need to go watch and check out, and we would recommend our listeners check out as well. So a couple of takeaways from me for that interview. What was your big takeaway?
Well, for me, yeah, it's the same thing. I mean, I asked him last question, what would you tell everyone, you know, concerned about this issue? And he says, if you get picked up by the police for some reason or another and you have a knife on you, don't say anything and get your lawyer. And to me, that's the big thing to remember, because you know, I like to talk, and maybe even when I'm nervous I like to talk more. So
a lot of folks do.
So it's a good thing to remember, just kind of keep your mouth shut and ask for a lawyer.
Little housekeeping stuff here before we kind of wrap up. Want to remind you to subscribe to the Knife Junkie newsletter. That's at thenifejunkie.com/newsletter. And if you want to catch some of the past episodes of the Knife Junkie podcast, you can listen to those right online at thenifejunkie.com/listen. You can go back and hear Doug's previous interview or some of the other past shows that we've gotten. If you're just catching the Knife Junkie podcast, and you can go listen to the back catalog there, if you will. Bob, what's coming up next week?
Next week, I'm talking with Jeff Blauvelt of Tough Knives. And he is a great guy. I've gotten to speak with him a couple of times. And I've just been a long distance admirer of his knives for a long time. And actually, I loved his modding videos from way back in the day, 10 years ago on YouTube. And he's just, man, his knives are just beautiful.
Right.
And he's an art guy. I'm an art guy. We resonate on a couple of different levels. So I was really excited to talk to him.
Right. Just kind of had a good connection there, if you will.
Yeah, and I you know, hopefully that connection leads to someday my actually owning one of his knives.
All right. A goal there for us.
Indeed.
And I just wanted to say before we wrap up, happy Mother's Day to Mrs. Knife Junkie, who I understand actually does listen to the podcasts, contrary to what I said last week. So happy Mom's Day, Mrs. Knife Junkie.
And right back at your knife newbie wife.
That's right. Thank you, Bob. All right. Thanks, everybody, for listening to the Knife Junkie podcast. For Bob, the Knife Junkie DeMarco, I'm Jim, the Knife Newbie Person, and happy Mother's Day again to all the moms out there that are listening.
Thanks for listening to the Knife Junkie podcast. If you enjoyed the show, please rate and review at reviewthepodcast.com. For show notes for today's episode, additional resources, and to listen to past episodes, visit our website, theknifejunkie.com. You can also watch our latest videos on YouTube at theknifejunkie.com/YouTube. Check out some great knife photos on theknifejunkie.com/Instagram, and join our Facebook group at theknifejunkie.com/Facebook. And if you have a question or comment, email them to bob@theknifejunkie.com or call our 24/7 listener line at 724-466-4487, and you may hear your comment or question answered on an upcoming episode of the Knife Junkie Podcast.